Good job.
Ông chủ tịch cam to cái tâm đa ca nội tệ phí sản đa ca sản đa ca nội thay này ông chủ tịch cam to phương tâm đa ca sẽ đập sẽ khai cam nợ chấm liền mori bên chóm hai nâng miền triềm nơi đào mặt đằng rọp đầu ní mười rúp đây miền hà tĩnh pì xì xì phí mười pon học sụp buồn cái làm gì sản đa ca độ dày sai câu vị thi lời đi ca pì than pì vật tâm miền vật tâm miền pì ký nâng bậc cùn để ông chủ tịch có hỏi chơi nhà châu rùm nâng không cái tâm đa ca sản đa ca ngày nay
សូមគោរពលោកប្រធានសម្រាប់សកម្មភាពនៅថ្ងៃនេះ And the Chinese mean that the Dunra Papini Mumrong Miru, that Miras name, PTCCP, Dom Hawks of Boon. So Makun of Tin.
Okun. The Bonnie, I met the right list of now some of the Boston Chopchout, Nontier Jimonson, on your breath, Bandoli cut from Labon set your room, Samnaka, like Tol, Knomotop Samnakani, the Boston Chopchout, Nontier, just like him a pay, had a large number of Mui. បញ្ជាក់ថារកគាត់មានបញ្ហាសុខភាពឈឺក្បាលឈឺចង្កេះមិនអាយអង្គុយយូរបានណៃចង់អារម្មណ៍បានយូរនិងដើម្បីមានលទ្ធភាពចូលរួមសកម្មការនៃថ្ងៃខាងមុខឲ្យមានប្រសិទ្ធភាពខ្លួនធំលះបងសិតចូលរួមនិងមានវត្តមានដល់ផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទុកសកម្មការនៅថ្ងៃទី20ខែតុលាឆ្នាំ2026បានឃើញកំណត់ហេតុពីនិត្យសុខភាពជូនចុះប្រយោជន៍នួនជាដែលធ្វើឡើងដោយគ្រូពេទ្យប្រចាំការពីនិត្យព្យាបាលថែទាំសុខភាពជូនចុះប្រយោជន៍នៅអវតកចុះថ្ chia phải chấm hơi căn để chư nơi về đồng cười du nâng có đau là nút sát thá thông với ông nhầm ra anh nhát ở lục đồn chí chỗ ruộng tam đàn cách tầm là ca sạm là cá vì một tụng mùi thật cao xa sạm là cá đi bài lưu mù lực thán đi hình dung tam bật bình nhạc bị thiên bài tầm mùi pram đầy bị thiên tầy khăn ông ở vô tố có ông nhầm ra anh nhát ở chân chấp trọn đồn chí chỗ ruộng tam đàn cách tầm là ca sạm là cá vì chung ngái vì một tụng khung khuôn mùi thật cao xa sạm là cá đi tam dựa bộ cao xa tuốt tầm đạp dạp bê sạm là cá bênh mùi thường ngày đi ประกอบไอ้บล็อกบล็อกเล็กแต่ชดตัวจบประพันธ์ต่อตัวสำหรับเป็นจบยอดหนุนจีอาจจะรวมตามด่านการจำนาการสามนาการเป็นจำนายขนมปังเปิลในการจำนาการสามนาการสำหรับไงนี่เกี่ยวกับต่อตัวนี้เราดูการจุนเตอร์สัพเพญาอันตรายเชียดนำไปมันต่อการตั้งสมรสในดาวจิปุ่นในจุนเนียง
Good morning, Your Honors, Council, Civil Parties, and Mr. Expert. Professor, just a reminder to wait for the microphone light, and I will also try to pause and turn off my microphone. I think when we finished yesterday, we had talked about the various relations between the Soviet Union, China, Vietnam, and how those affected Cambodia. I'd now like to ask you about China's reaction to the December 25th, 1978 Vietnamese invasion of Cambodia, where they captured Phnom Penh on the 7th of January, 79. How did China react to that?
ក្របក្តាប់ទីក្រុងភ្នំពេញនៅថ្ងៃ 7 មករា 1979 តើ China reacted very angrily to that.
Sent
troops to the border and began its own war against
Vietnam.
And when you say their own little war, can you briefly describe what happened in that conflict?
Fighting took place on the Vietnamese, the northern Vietnamese region near the Chinese border. China sent large numbers of troops and artillery in order to prevent Vietnam from sending all of its troops into Cambodia.
If you can, if you think this is appropriate, can you compare that Chinese military action entering Vietnam to the two Vietnamese incursions, the 77, late 77 incursion where they then withdrew at the end of the year, early 78, and the invasion at the end of 1978 where they ended up occupying Cambodia? How would you compare the Chinese military action to those two? Is it similar to one or the other?
Well, it was a little bit more than the first incursion, but a bit less than the second invasion and occupation, because it didn't involve the invasion and occupation of all of Vietnam, only northern provinces.
Would you say that China's part of its intent was to simply teach Vietnam a lesson that, and remind them that it had a neighbor that was more powerful on its border?
If I recall correctly, teaching Vietnam a lesson was, in fact, the terminology used by Deng Xiaoping to describe their behavior towards, or their intention towards Vietnam. It wasn't to occupy or control Vietnam, but to punish Vietnam for sending troops into Cambodia and to make sure that it could constrain the dispatch of further Vietnamese troops into Cambodia.
Thank you. Now I'd like to turn to a few points from your thesis that I think we can go through quite quickly. So your thesis is E3/10699, and the first point that I wish to make appears on 01335193 of the thesis, where you write the following: between January and April 1978, Hanoi had gradually shifted its appellation from, quote, the Kampuchean authorities to, quote, the Phnom Penh authorities. By June, it had become the Pol Pot Ing Sari clique. I'd like you to comment on that, but first, keeping in mind something that was quoted yesterday, I'll just repeat it. This is written by Dmitry Masyakov, E39644, my ERN 0112-0075, in French 0112-5304, and in English 010-859-7425. Yesterday how he wrote that Lee Duan, the leader of the Vietnamese communists, in a conversation with the Soviet ambassador, called a politician of pro-Vietnam orientation as the occupant of the second most important post in the party.
Considered
by the Vietnamese the second most important person in the party.
Pol Pot and Yeng Sri were brothers in law. They were
married to sisters.
And therefore, I believe that the Vietnamese regarded them as being closer than they might actually have been in terms of the power hierarchy. Moreover, the Vietnamese didn't know Pol Pot or Yen Sri from the Indo-Chinese Communist Party training days. In other words, that they were not part of the Cambodian leadership that was trained in Hanoi at any time. Because of that, they misattributed power to Yen Sri. Yen Sri was not the second most powerful person in the Cambodian Communist Party. I would regard him as much lower down, and Mr. Nguyen Chia is more likely deserving of the position of the second most powerful. So it was a case of misunderstanding by the Vietnamese of where power lay in Cambodia.
Thank you. And so just to be clear, you didn't misunderstand me, the Masikov quote that I just gave, he refers to Nguyen Chea as the occupant of the second most important post in the party. And I read to you, of course, several other quotations from your own book and others about the Vietnamese considering Nguyen Chea of being sympathetic to them, our man. Pro-Vietnam orientation. So another question I have for you is, after the invasion in early 79, I'm sure you were aware that the Vietnamese held trials in absentia here in Phnom Penh, where they put on trial in absentia Pol Pot and Ing Sari. If they knew Nguyen Chea was number two in the regime, why didn't they name him?
I'm not sure that they knew that Nguyen Chea was number two in the regime in terms of actual power. And as I said, they misunderstood the relative power of Yen Sri. Not that he was not powerful, but that he was not as powerful as Nguyen Chea.
Let me ask you to consider the following. Hypothesis. At that time, Khmer Rouge was still a military force. If the Vietnamese continued to believe that their man, the person sympathetic to them, was Nguyen Chea, the last thing they would want to do is to cut off the possibility that he would defect or break off with a group of Khmer Rouge that they could negotiate with. Can you respond to that?
I can respond to that. I can respond to that. I can respond to that.
The microphone wasn't on, but I understood the witness to ask me to repeat or rephrase the question. I'll try to do that. I want to put the following hypothesis to you for your reaction. At that time, in 1979, the Khmer Rouge was still a military force fighting the Vietnamese. And if the Vietnamese had hopes, which would seem to be very reasonable, that the Khmer Rouge party could break up, that some of the more moderate factions might seek an accommodation or even defect to the Vietnamese side. And they believe that Nguyen Chia was their man, a person of pro-Vietnam orientation, sympathetic to their cause. They would not have wanted to put him on trial, condemn him to life or death, and cut off that possibility that he would be someone they could deal with and separate him from Pol Pot.
Well, I think that's a reasonable hypothesis, it seems to me. I think that what they thought of Nguyen Chia by 1979 is something I can't comment on because I don't have any evidence of what they thought in 1979. As you know, the quotes that I have provided came from earlier years. Before the invasion. And whether they still thought of Nguyen Chia in those terms after the invasion, I do not know. So that would be one possible alternative explanation of why they did what they did. But still, I would emphasize their Vietnamese ignorance of the real nature of the leadership of Democratic Campuchia led them to think that there was something called the Pol Pot Yeng Sari genocide.
Thank you.
Now another small point in relation to the popularity of the what Sina called the Khmer Rouge communist movement in Vietnam prior to the Lon Nol coup and the alliance with Sina. How did they do, or did any party that represented their views do in the 1955 elections?
I don't recall them doing exceptionally well in the 1955 elections. I don't believe that they were popular.
Thank you. So I'm going to just read a quote from your thesis, I believe I have it. And this is from the same document, your thesis, at ERN 01335066. You wrote that Prachia Chong fared badly. The pro-Hanoi party won only 29,509 votes, which was 4% of the total. First of all, who is the Prachia Chong party?
This was the front party for the people of pro-Vietnamese communist orientation.
And were those the people that became what Sina called the Khmer Rouge?
At that time, what Sina called the Khmer Rouge hadn't been formed.
Yes. The question is, did these members of this party eventually join that movement?
Yes.
Now, during the defense examination, you were asked about the Democratic Campuchia's relationship with Thailand, whether they had reasonable diplomatic relations with their neighbors on the western border. I'd like to draw your attention to a couple documents we have on the case file. First, Your Honors, E3/8177. And Professor, this is a New York Times article from the 23rd of December 1977. The ERNs are in English 00165991. And in French, the ERN is 00597761 and 62. And it's reporting on a visit of the Thai Prime Minister to the border. The article says, quote,
Prime Minister
Prime Minister Khmer, Skipping down a few paragraphs, Thai officials are mystified at Cambodia's intensification of the attacks across the Thai border. At a time when intelligence reports that are considered reliable indicate major fighting is also taking place on Cambodia's eastern border with Vietnam. And before I get your comments on this, I'd like you to consider one other document. And this is an article, short article from the Los Angeles Times, dated 29th of August, 1977. Your Honor, the document number is E3/8272. The ERNs are in English 01-661-12. In Khmer, 00-834-835. And in French, 00-822-432. The article reads that quote, Cambodia said Sunday that its army had clashed with foreign troops in four regions, apparently confirming recent reports of border skirmishes with Vietnam, Laos, and Thailand. Radio Phnom Penh monitored here, and the article byline is Bangkok, praise government soldiers for their, quote, heroic defense, unquote, against foreign troops in the north, northwest, east, and northeast. It did not identify the foreign forces. The Thai Prime Minister, Khanin Kavichin, said earlier this month that Cambodia was behaving like a, quote, bull in a China shop, unquote, on its borders with Laos, Vietnam, and Thailand. So, sir, considering that the radio Phnom Penh confirmed border skirmishes in the northwest, northwestern and northern borders, and the statements of the Thai Prime Minister, do you have any further comments on the question council originally asked you about how reasonable DK was in its relations with its western neighbors, the Thais?
Yes, I regard The behavior of the DK leadership is fundamentally irrational, and the comment by the Thai official that it was behaving like a bull in a china shop
perhaps apt.
I believe that Pol Pot was trying to demonstrate his potency, so to speak, to all his neighbors,
in false belief that
his revolution, being the purest communist revolution so far, was able to intimidate all rival powers. I believe that it was irrational because the forces aligned against Cambodia, against the democratic Kampuchea regime, were far, far more powerful. And whatever the nature of the disputes, even granted, even if one was for sake of argument to say that Cambodia had a case against Vietnam, it still made no sense for Cambodia to fight against Thailand or Laos. It indicated the disconnect from reality of the leaders of democratic Cambodia. But
thank you. Now I'd like to ask you about a couple of telegrams. I think you were asked by the defense whether you had read contemporaneous DK documents and you indicated that was not part of your research. So I would like you to consider these. First,
Your Honor, E3/243.
It's a telegram number 15. It's dated 19th of January 1978, which we believe is the alias of Sokhoeum, to Brother Pol,
copies to Brother Pol, and office.
The document, the telegram indicated, again, this is from the East Zone, we launched guerrilla attack in their territory 2 kilometers from our border. Result, we smashed 30 military houses and burned down several civilian houses. We smashed two enemy motorboat boats. Their people in the motorboats were all destroyed. In total, we smashed 30 enemies on 18 January. Also on 18 January, at 3 a.m. we continued firing rocket 107 into Hong Kong, we could not grasp the result. However, we saw it was on fire. So again, this is a telegram dated 19 January 1978, which would have been shortly after the Vietnamese withdrawal from the first attempt to teach a lesson to Vietnam in that 77 incursion. The second telegram is dated the 8th of April 1978. Runners, this is E3/1076. Again, it's a one-page document. And there's a handwritten note indicating it's copied to Ban, who I understand is the alias of Yang Sirik. And the first paragraph labeled number 1 reports, quote, "We attacked and entered the Thong Thap population center and the market south of Trapang Priem and Thang Chao. We killed and wounded many hundreds of them and burned hundreds of fire of houses. We continue to fire 107 millimeters in DK 7 to Tan Chau. So the question I had asked you yesterday, you indicated that Cambodian attacks into Vietnam continued after the Vietnamese withdrew in early 1978. Would these documents seem to confirm your position?
Yes.
And do they provide you any evidence of whether the attacks in Vietnam were local initiatives or things done under the direction and with reporting to the center?
At this stage of the conflict, I find it very hard to believe that these actions were taking place without reporting to the center, without the knowledge of the center, and without the approval of the center. They must have been part of the general strategy.
Thank you very much. Before I move into my final failed to recognize earlier the atrocities
of Khmer.
Yes, Gareth Porter and George Hildebrand
Called
Sydney Schanberg was late to, from the point of view of a reporter who was in Cambodia during the war, during the 70-75 war, was late to understand what the Khmer Rouge was all about. But he did report with reasonable accuracy, I believe, what happened with the evacuation of Phnom Penh shortly thereafter.
And sir, lest anyone think that your testimony here is somehow biased in favor of Vietnam over Cambodia, can you briefly explain, did you take any public stand during what in the United States is called the Vietnam War?
Can you explain your position?
Yes, I was a supporter of the United States and Australian intervention in Vietnam publicly. I believe that that conflict was strategically sound, despite the fact that this is not a popular opinion even today,
that there was strategic interest at the time of the intervention. ខ្ញុំគិតថាការអន្តរកម្មនេះជាការអន្តរកម្មប្រកបដោយយុទ្ធសាស្ត្រដូច្នេះអ្វីដែលកើតឡើងនៅបច្ចុប្បន្ននេះគឺវាមិនពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងអ្វីដែលកើតឡើងនៅក្នុងទសវត្សរ៍ឆ្នាំ60នេះឡើយ
Thank you. Now I'd like to switch the topic.
សូមអរគុណឥឡូវនេះខ្ញុំសូមបន្តទៅប្រធានបទមួយទៀតតាក់ទងទៅនឹងខ្មែរក្រហម
Actions
គឺសកម្មភាពរបស់ខ្មែរក្រហមប្រឆាំងជនជាតិវៀតណាម
And first I'd like to quote from Nayan Chanda's book. That's E3/23776@English00192271. French 00023691. Khmer 00191401-2. I'm sure you've read Mr. Chanda's book, but you may not recall this.
ឆ្នាំ77នៅឧដុ
ង្គក្នុងពេលដែលរងចាំ
មេស្រុកខ្មែរក្រហមមកដល់ដើម្បីណែនាំគាត់អំពីឡានណាដែលត្រូវជួសជុលនោះ
គឺថាគាត់ងាកគោរបស់គាត់
ហើយគាត់ឃើញលិខិតនៅលើតុមួយដែលសរសេរថាបញ្ជាពី
807
គឺលិខិតនោះចុះថ្ងៃទី1មេសាឆ្នាំ1977
Says that Rossum told him that the chilling message of the directive was clear. All ethnic Vietnamese in the district and all Khmers who spoke Vietnamese or had Vietnamese friends should be handed over to the state security service. Before I get your comment on that, I'd also like to read to you a transcript of testimony in this court earlier this year, the 2nd of February 2016, and this is transcript B1/386.1. The dialogue I'm about to read is found at 15:57:30.
គឺសាក់សៃមាសវឿនតបានជាសួរថាតើលោកធ្លាប់ឮថាមានផែនការកំទេចវៀតណាមដែលរស់នៅក្នុងប្រទេសកម្ពុជាចន្លោះពីឆ្នាំ1975ដល់1979ទេអខិមគួរបញ្ជាក់ប្រាប់លោកថាមាសវឿនគឺជាមេបញ្ជាការមួយគឺជាមេបញ្ជាការរបស់ខ្មែរក្រហម
He answered, yes, I heard about that.
ខ្ញុំធ្លាប់ឮអំពីផែនការនេះខ្ញុំឮអំពីជនជាតិវៀតណាមដែលរស់នៅក្នុងប្រទេសកម្ពុជា
គា
ត់និយាយថាដំបូងចាប់ពីឆ្នាំ1970
សង្គមរបស់គេបញ្ជូន
ត្រឡប់ទៅប្រទេសរបស់គេដល់រដ្ឋាភិបាលកម្ពុជាហើយបន្តរហូតដល់ឆ្នាំ75
But then for us, later on, we were instructed that Vietnamese had to be smashed because they did not return to their country. There were then clashes along the border due to this issue. That's what I heard. Sir, my question first to you is, do you have any...
Yes, Mr. President, I think we rose almost simultaneously.
I'm not sure if you're going to be able to do this.
Qui plus est, Monsieur le Président, je rajoute, puisque je me souviens très bien de ce témoin, puisque je l'ai contre-interrogé, et je me souviens également que le lendemain, lors de mon contre-interrogatoire, et même, je crois, en répondant le lendemain de cette déclaration à Monsieur le procureur Vincent de Ville à l'époque, le témoin a changé sa déclaration. Donc, pour être complet, puisqu'on nourrit l'expert de documents qu'il ne connaît pas, il faudrait peut-être donner l'intégralité de la déposition de ce témoin sur ce point. Et le lendemain, alors je vous dis ça de tête, mon équipe est en train de rechercher la référence, mais je me souviens très bien que le lendemain, la position de ce témoin était différente. Donc je pense qu'en toute clarté, c'est important de le
noter. Your Honor, I believe the statement of Ms. Moon is absolutely clear, but if counsel wants to put other parts of his testimony to the witness, of course, she has the opportunity to do so. As for the first objection, this is an expert witness.
I haven't even asked a question yet for it to be leaked, but an expert witness is entitled to give an opinion based upon information that's placed before him, just as counsel placed information before him.
Puisque maintenant j'ai retrouvé la référence, je peux la donner à la Chambre. Donc c'est le même témoin à l'audience du 3 février
2020. Why is she now arguing the case? This isn't an objection. This is her presenting her case. This is what the prosecution is doing all the time with us and always gets away with it. And I asked the question at the expert's open questions, and then I confronted her with the question. Thank you. The question that I'm asking, which I think, by the way, when counsel hears it, will understand, is no way included in the information I read. The answer is not included. And based on your research, this evidence of democratic Kampuchea targeting the civilian Vietnamese, ethnic Vietnamese population, and those in any way connected to Vietnam within Cambodia, did that information reach the Vietnamese authorities?
Đăng đó anh nhà thờ bảo Việt Nam thế.
I do not know.
Khiêm mặt đăng thế.
Do you recall if there were any press reports about Vietnamese being targeted that you can recall during that time period?
Rìa cả thà chuyện chuyện Việt Nam thì ban kia cầm nát cô đau nơi Campuchia vậy đã được thế.
No, I don't recall press reports from that time.
Now I'd like to read a couple more things to you. One of them is from your own book, at page 104. And the ERN is 01001771. And you were talking then about what the Khmer Rouge was saying about having defeated the Vietnamese 77 incursion. You said, quote, the claim of having achieved only 1/30th of the losses of the Vietnamese was pure fiction. But according to the logic of the now official formula, Democratic Kampuchea's prospects were broken. In any future armed conflict with Vietnam. You then have a quote, which your footnote indicates, you're citing Phnom Penh Radio, 10 May 1978. You quote the radio broadcast as saying, using these figures, one Cambodian soldier is equal to 30 Vietnamese soldiers. If we have 2 million troops, there should be 60 million Vietnamese. For this reason, 2 million troops should be more than enough to fight the Vietnamese. Because Vietnam has only 50 million inhabitants. We do not need 8 million people. We need only 2 million troops to crush the 50 million Vietnamese, and we still would have 6 million people left. And another document I bring to your attention, which I think is consistent with what you've quoted. This is E3/4640. It's the April 1978 edition of Revolutionary Flag magazine contemporary style. You said that the document, the April 1978 Revolutionary Flag, published a speech of Pol Pot on the occasion of the third anniversary of the 17 April victory. There may be some views that the UN are very large. The UN have a population of 50 million and Cambodia has only 8 million. So how can we win? That would be hard as they have nearly 1 million troops. Our troops number less than 100,000. So how can 8 million fight 50 million aggressors? He goes on to say, the party made the determination to fight and smash large numbers of the enemy life forces and to protect our forces to maximum. This is our slogan, looking at the numbers. One of us must fight 30 UN. If we can implement this slogan, we win. So when we have 2 million, we already have more than we need to fight them because they only have 50 million. We don't need to use 8 million. We can use the force of only 2 million to fight and smash the UN and still have 6 million left. So first I'd like you to comment upon these various pronouncements of the DK regime about sacrificing apparently 2 million Cambodians to kill all 50 million Vietnamese. Your comment. E3/4699, page 01355066. You wrote the following. The radical Cambodian students also criticized the use by other Cambodians of the common pejorative term Yuen to refer to the Vietnamese. Is it correct that your research showed you that the radical leftist Cambodians criticized people using that word Yuen as being a pejorative term?
Yes, that was true. That was a reference to one source of mine who was a fellow student of some of the Khmer Rouge leaders in France during the 1950s or late 40s.
You say seen or recognized that many Cambodians hated the Vietnamese so much that they dreamed of reconquering some lost territories.
Vietnam hay puk ke aich nang leh bang tuk dai mu chumnuon
bai Vietnam
pantae khnong tumneak tumneol bop khnyom chmuoy Vietnam
khnyom tae tae
pra da tu tae da anuvat da kap ke yal srom srob hay khnyom ke tha puk kwat che sach
che neak chit khang bop khnyom keu che neak chit khang khnong chnam 60 million inhabitants about 50 times more than Cambodia then.
ហើយនៅក្នុងពេលសង្គ្រាមវៀតណាមខាងជើងខាងត្បូងគឺ
very dangerous neighbor to be handled with care.
ទោះបីយ៉ាងណាក៏ដោយពួកគាត់គឺជា
សាច់ញាតិដែល
ជាអ្នកចិត្តខាងដល់គ្រោះថ្នាក់បំផុតតតើលោកយល់យ៉ាងណាដែរចំពោះអ្វីដែលសម្ដេចសៀនុបានសរសេរនេះ
Yes, I think that Sihanouk was very prudent in his a belief that it was the purest of communist revolutions
hitherto,
that the normal processes of prudence in international politics did not apply to Cambodia because the Cambodian communists were their revolution was superior to that of the Vietnamese and anybody else.
And therefore they were able to achieve successes
that other people would not consider practical.
ដូច្នេះអ្វីដែលកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យធ្វើគឺមនុស្សទូទៅគិតថាមិនមែនជារឿងប្រកាសនិយមឡើយដូច្នេះចំពោះកម្ពុជាវិញខ្ញុំគិតថាដោយសារតែមនោគមវិជ្ជាហើយនឹងការយល់ខុសអំពីកម្លាំងរបស់ខ្លួនកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យមិនយល់ឃើញដូចសម្ដេចព្រះបរមរតនកោដ្ឋ
And my final question.
ព្រះញ្ញាសូមអរគុណលោកអ្នកជំនាញឥឡូវនេះខ្ញុំមានសំណួរចុងក្រោយក្នុងរយៈពេល3ថ្ងៃកន្លងមកដែលយើងនិយាយអំពីគោលនយោបាយកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យចំពោះវៀតណាមវិញហើយនឹងចំពោះជនស៊ីវិលវៀតណាមនៅក្នុងកម្ពុជាក៏ដូចនៅប្រទេសវៀតណាមដែរក្នុងទស្សនៈលោកជាអ្នកជំនាញ
ថាតើ
គោលនយោបាយរបស់កម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យនឹងវាមានឥទ្ធិពលអ្វីចំពោះចំពោះជាតិកម្ពុជាចំពោះប្រទេសមួយដែលមានបូរណភាពទឹកដីនិងមានឯករាជ្យភាពតើវាមានផលប៉ះពាល់អ្វីដល់កម្ពុជា
I believe that
Professor, thank you, Mr. President. I have no further questions. I turn it over to my colleagues, civil parties.
Ông chủ nhiệm chuyên trách từ mua khi nhâm sôm bên chấp cả xã sườn bậc khi nhâm hay khi nhâm sôm bậc cô
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour à tous. Je m'appelle Marie. Je représente le collectif des victimes qui se sont constituées par des civils dans ce procès. Et je les représente aux côtés de mon confrère Ong Pik. Beaucoup de choses ont été dites durant ces trois jours de témoignages, dont je vais avoir quelques questions de précision, de suivi. N'hésitez pas à me dire si vous avez l'impression que vous avez déjà parfaitement et pleinement répondu aux questions que je souhaite vous poser ce matin. J'aurai toute une série de questions sur la culture politique des régimes marxistes-léninistes dont vous nous avez dit durant ces deux jours que la paranoïa était un élément central. Et puis j'aurai une deuxième série de questions sur ce que vous avez nommé hier l'hyper-maoïsme et l'impact qu'a pu avoir cet hyper-maoïsme sur les Cambodgiens pendant le régime du Kampuchea démocratique. Pour commencer sur la dimension de la culture politique des régimes marxistes-léninistes qui intègrent une tendance paranoïaque. Est-ce que j'ai bien compris votre témoignage hier que vous considérez que le PCK ne faisait pas exception et que lui aussi avait au cœur de sa culture politique une tendance paranoïaque?
Yes, you understood correctly.
But
je vous remercie. Vous expliquez dans votre ouvrage que cette culture tient pour partie à la personnalité des dirigeants et vous parlez des personnalités notamment de Staline et de Hitler. À la page 13 de votre ouvrage, 01001682, et vous faites en quelque sorte un parallèle avec Mao et Pol Pot. Vous expliquez à la page suivante de votre ouvrage qu'il existe pour ces personnalités de type paranoïaque un délire de persécution d'une part et un délire de grandeur d'autre part. Pouvez-vous expliquer à la Cour cette double dimension de la tendance paranoïaque de ces leaders, persécution d'une part et délire de grandeur d'autre part?
Yes, all these totalitarian dictators, people who have absolute power, have a tremendous sense of delirium about their own greatness.
And,
They create personality cults, which was only started in the kind of temperature towards the regime.
They create personality cults such as we saw with Stalin and Mao, generating the idea that they
become gods.
Je vous remercie. Je crois que vous avez résumé ce que vous venez de nous dire dans votre ouvrage en disant, dans la conclusion de l'ouvrage à la page 239-001-912, que les marxistes-léninistes rejettent le rôle de l'accident dans l'histoire, mais ont tendance à voir l'histoire comme une conspiration, comme une conspiration. Est-ce que c'est finalement ce qui s'appliquait au Kampuchea démocratique?
Yes, I think that is exactly what was happening.
Je vous remercie. Vous développez cette thèse d'une tendance paranoïaque dans la culture politique de ces régimes en parlant de ce que vous appelez des pseudo-communautés. Et du coup, je vais vous citer un extrait de votre livre en anglais. Je préviens les interprètes pour que vous puissiez un petit peu nous expliquer ce que vous entendez par là et vous indiquez donc en anglais. Another important aspect of the paranoid thought process is construction of the paranoid pseudo-community. As the paranoid individual's delusions evolve, they become systematized. The ideas of persecution by separate individuals or groups become organized in such a way that the person eventually feels that all the persecutors are actually unified in a single group, plotting against the individual.
et
vous dites un peu plus loin. We should recall how each such regime's internal political dissidents and even the non-dissident enemy social classes targeted by the regime are always falsely perceived as agents of hostile foreign powers. Pouvez-vous donner un petit peu plus d'explications à la Chambre sur cette construction d'un système par lequel tous les ennemis deviennent agrégés et deviennent des agents de pouvoir étrangers hostiles?
Yes. Just as Stalin created a construct whereby his left-wing opponents, his communist rivals, were in alignment with foreign powers of non-Marxist orientation, like the British, the French, the Chinese, or the Americans, so Pol Pot constructed a paranoid pseudo-community whereby it was the enemies within who were aligned with either the CIA or the KGB, which, as I testified previously, were not in any alliance relationship at all, but on contrary, were in a very conflicted adversarial relationship. But the paranoid dictator puts together these two rival enemies as plotting together against him and his regime. This is an explanation for the very bizarre, some of the very bizarre speeches which we have heard about in this hearing.
Merci. Vous venez de parler de Pol Pot et son régime. Vous évoquez souvent la personnalité de Pol Pot. Vos recherches vous ont permis de penser aussi le rôle de l'encart en tant qu'entité par rapport à Pol Pot. Qui était finalement l'entité paranoïaque, et comment vous voyez l'interaction de Pol Pot et de ses proches?
Could you restate that question? I'm sorry.
Vous parlez souvent de Pol Pot, que vous décrivez comme ayant une culture à tendance paranoïaque. Vos recherches vous ont-elles permis d'étendre cette idée à d'autres membres du régime du Cambodge démocratique? Pensez-vous que la personnalité de Pol Pot en tant que telle a été un élément déterminant?
I think the movement, the political movement, the Communist Party of Kampuchea, was itself being a conspiratorial organization affected by this paranoid political culture. My argument is that the dictator who dominates the political elites tends to be more extreme than his colleagues. But there is a degree of paranoia within the ruling circles of the Revolutionary Party. Because of the nature of the party as a conspiratorial organization.
Vous avez utilisé hier, me semble-t-il, le terme de conspiration fantastique.
Fantastic plot.
Vous parlez de ce phénomène de création de pseudo-communautés des ennemis a priori venant de points très divergents étaient amalgamés par le régime. Est-ce que c'est un terme que vous pouvez expliquer, ce terme de conspiration fantastique?
These plots are created out of nothing, really. I mean, the idea that there is this conspiracy of disparate forces internationally against the regime is pure fantasy. Now, this is not to say that there may not have been plots against the regime. I'm not saying that. But the construction of the nature of the plot is fantastic. It's unbelievable. When I talk about this paranoid pseudo community of the KGB and the CIA working together to overthrow democratic Kampuchea, this is what is fantastic.
Je vous remercie. Je voudrais vous citer un passage d'une déclaration de Nguyen Chi Ya. Que Nguyen Chi Ya a fait en audience le 31 octobre 2013. Où il s'exprime et il parle au peuple cambodgien pour donner sa version des événements du Kampuchea démocratique. Et donc il dit, le 31 octobre 2013, transcript E1-237.1, il est 10h36, 43, et donc je cite en français, Nguyen Chi Ya s'adresse à la Chambre et il répond aux questions. Pour répondre aux questions posées par la Chambre et par des membres du public, les événements stratégiques s'étant produits pendant la période du Kampuchea démocratique ont été causés par les raisons suivantes. Premièrement, le PCK a décidé par erreur de recruter certains cadres qui ont trahi et qui n'ont pas compris la ligne du parti. Et pour certains, restaient et travaillaient à Phnom Penh sans se rendre régulièrement dans les coopératives. Deuxièmement, certains chefs de zone et de secteurs autonomes et certains cadres étaient des agents infiltrés par les Vietnamiens et les Américains et qui ont trahi la révolution. Leurs activités étaient destinées à détruire le mouvement du PCK et la population du Cambodge et le pays. Ils n'ont pas suivi la politique du PCK ni ses instructions. Ils ont tué et maltraité la population en les affamant et en les forçant à travailler de façon arbitraire. Fait qu'ils cachaient dans leur rapport inventé qu'ils envoyaient au comité central du parti. Ils ont eu recours à toutes sortes de méthodes pour inciter la population à se retourner contre la révolution. Ceci a affaibli la révolution, nous exposant à l'invasion par l'ennemi. Les chefs de la zone Est privaient la population de nourriture et exportaient secrètement du riz vers le Vietnam. C'était eux qui faisaient en sorte que la peau extérieure soit craquante alors que l'intérieur restait
crue.
Je vais m'arrêter là pour cet exemple. Donc c'est ce que nous dit Nguyen Chi Ya, et c'est la ligne de défense qu'il adopte dans ce procès. Y voyez-vous finalement une continuité par rapport à ce que vous venez de décrire et cette façon d'amalgamer les ennemis et de voir l'histoire comme une grande conspiration? Voyez-vous une continuité entre la politique du PCK et la façon dont se défend Nguyen Chi Ya aujourd'hui en audience?
Yes, I see some examples here, although I think that what Nguyen Chia is saying is to post blame to the elements who turned out to be aligning themselves later with the Vietnamese. I understand, I'm not an expert on the relative conditions of various regions of Kampuchea under the democratic Kampuchea regime, but I was told once by a person who has been a witness before this tribunal, Mr. Stephen Hedder, that the people in the eastern zone actually ate better than the rest than some other regions. I don't believe that problems of starvation and disease, which were the major killer of Cambodian people under the democratic democratic Kampuchea regime, I don't believe that starvation and disease were a product of the peculiar policies of the eastern zone. I believe that there was a central policy of the depopulation of the cities, the abolition of money, the creation of huge communes, and extensive hard labor, grueling labor conditions, lack of medicine. All of these factors were a result of a central policy rather than a peculiar situation in the eastern zone. I think that, therefore, Nguyen Chia is trying to take the blame away from the central command of Democratic Kampuchea in order to explain the terrible things that happened.
And sur.
បាទឥឡូវនេះដល់ម៉ោងសម្រាប់ហើយហើយប្រកាសសម្រាប់ចាប់ពីនេះតទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 11:00 ខ្វះ 25 នាទីសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្រាប់ការមន្ត្រីរដ្ឋបាលតុលាការរដ្ឋប្រដកកន្លែងសម្រាប់នៅបន្ទប់ក្រុមចាំមេមត្រៈស្័យដល់សាស្ត្រស័យជំនាញរូបនេះនៅក្នុងឡុងពេលជុំសម្រាប់នឹងអញ្ជើញគាត់មកកាន់កន្លែងផ្ដោតសេកម្មក្នុងបន្ទប់សម្រាប់ការនេះវិញនៅវេលាម៉ោង 11:00 ខ្វះ 25 នាទីសម្រ